Ladies and gentlemen, Alex Jones here, back in the saddle, Austin, Texas. And I won't be leaving until about a week and a half from now, and I'll only miss one show then. I'm going to Canada to speak with George Norrie up there in Toronto two Saturdays from now, but I'm going to be hanging around the command base pretty much exclusively here and hosting 6 days a week, Monday through Friday, from 11 a.m. to 2 p.m., and then, of course, back Sundays, 4 to 6 p.m., all times central. There's a lot of big news happening in this world, a lot of incredible things happening. We're going to cover it all after this quick break. But at the center of it, not just here in the United States, but in other countries, I witnessed this in Europe, all you hear about is Donald Trump. Is this planet Donald Trump? I think he's a paradox. I haven't made my mind about Donald Trump. But here's John Bound's take on it right now.
America, remember when a young upstart Illinois Senator Barack Obama promised everything under the sun? Obama promised to cut the deficit in half. Well, it was $10 trillion then. It's over $18 trillion now. Obama promised shovel-ready American jobs. But as Obama's golf games increased and he spent millions of taxpayer dollars on his vacations, he ignored his jobs council, eventually disbanding it. And now we have an economy with more than one-third of the country on welfare. Not to mention an emboldened surveillance state, militarized constitution-despising police, a middle-class destroying healthcare program, wide-open borders, huge foreign policy failures in the Middle East, Europe, and South America, an impending corporate world government courtesy of the TPP, and a nation increasingly divided on race. Basically, everything Obama promised was a big fat lie. His biggest achievement appears to be the ability to lead the American people along like lemmings.
Nature and her infinite wisdom has spared a few. Back on the Arctic plain, there remains the small handful that did not make this fatal journey.
So who's the globalist straw man this time around? Could it be Donald Trump? The Washington Post reported that former President Bill Clinton had a private telephone conversation in late spring with Donald Trump at the same time that the billionaire investor and reality television star was nearing a decision to run for the White House, according to associates of both men. Four Trump allies and one Clinton associate familiar with the exchange said that Clinton encouraged Trump's efforts to play a larger role in the Republican Party and offered his own views of the political landscape. Donald Trump is a longtime friend of the Clintons. So what would the strategy look like in order for Trump to buttress Hillary's presidential campaign as she struggles with the shackles of her latest debacle of an FBI email investigation, where at least four of the emails on her private server were found to be classified? First, delay the Democratic presidential debate. Done. We won't see a Democratic presidential debate for over 2 months. And the handful of Democratic candidates are already complaining that the schedule of six primary debates are designed to allow Hillary to shine. Second, send in the Donald to stir up the Republican campaign. Test the waters by using promises and observations about America that Hillary can utilize later in her campaign.
If it weren't for me, you wouldn't even be talking about illegal immigration, Chris. You wouldn't even be talking about it. This was not a subject that was on anybody's mind until I brought it up at my announcement, and I said, Mexico is sending.
And once Trump has dominated and weakened the Republican field with his faux populism, Trump can jump right off the Republican bandwagon and run as a third-party candidate, further watering down Republican votes, which is something Trump has already hinted at. Here we are again, debate season. When the candidates actually talk about the criminal conspiracy that has devoured our government and transformed it into a corporation masquerading as a democracy. Not to be mentioned again once they are in office, as this brief season of populism and reflection of American values morphs into a reign of tyranny. John Bound for InfoWars.com.
We'll be back. Stay with us. Welcome, ladies and gentlemen. It's great to be back in the saddle. Fabulous job by the crew. Of course, our supporters, the great Liberty Lovers Worldwide, David Knight. While I've been out of the country for 2 weeks, but I have returned. We, of course, were reporting live from the road. Great job, Rob Dew, who accompanied me for the full 2 weeks. Buckley Hammond flew in because it was so much news to cover for the last week. and took his wife along with him. So it was a great trip, got a lot done, and we shot basically enough material for three micro-documentaries that I think are going to have a big effect. Talked to a Vatican insider who predicted 3 years ago on TV, radio, and in print that they would put basically Pope Francis in as a Jesuit, which is unprecedented. We got the rest of the inside scoop. We've got just a lot of amazing interviews, all HD, that'll be highly produced and powerful, that we're going to be airing over the next month on the nightly news and on this radio / TV transmission. But we are back. Thank you so much for joining us. I will get into Donald Trump, all things Donald. This is Planet Donald. And I don't normally go with whatever the big distraction du jour is. I didn't cover the Malaysian airline situation. Now, of course, they think they found it. I had a few guests on. I mentioned it when new developments came out. But compared to other media, mainstream media, alternative media, we covered it probably 1/100th of what they did, because that was a pure distraction. What does it matter at the end of the day? It's a sad tragedy, but compared to what's happening in the rest of the world, it is a diversion. That's why the media was running with it ad nauseum. But with something like Donald Trump, it's different, because it's about the 2016 election, the future of this country and the rest of the world. And whether he's a shill, whether he is for real, regardless of who Donald Trump really is, the study example of how the media is handling this, how they're spinning it, how people are responding tells you a lot. And I'll say this. If Donald Trump flip-flops, or if he obviously falls on his sword or drops the ball on purpose or lowers his fist during the 12th round, he will be anathema and hated in this country, and there will be no resuscitation for him with the body politic. That said, though, if he's a shill, he may not have a choice and is being blackmailed. Because I'll tell you, when you own casinos and you're involved financing both political parties, and you're tied in with the folks that the Donald's tied into, they can indict a ham sandwich in this country. You've seen them go after Mark Cuban and others for simply, you know, criticizing tyranny and indicting him for stock market stuff that was clearly not illegal. You see him indicting the Texas Attorney General for a crooked toenail, basically, while Hillary, again, gets money from third world dictators at her foundation when she's the head of the State Department to then sell them arms. Unprecedented stuff they get away with. So there's a lot going on here. And we're going to be covering Donald Trump quite a bit today. We don't have any guests because I want to be able to cover news, get to a lot of special reports and clips and analysis, and, of course, take your phone calls. But I do want to open the phones up in the first hour, into the second hour, on really what do you think about Donald Trump? I mean, with Pope Francis, we know he's a leftist, socialist, who wants carbon taxes and global government, and is coming to Congress to lecture. The Vatican says, here's AP, the Pope and Congress, Francis is certain to challenge lawmakers. So we're going to have an international religious leader here meddling domestically in our politics, telling us what to do. It is unprecedented. You've got the IRS harassing hundreds of thousands of Christians, thousands of churches, libertarian conservative groups, pro-gun groups, auditing them, taking away their 501c3, saying don't be politically involved, when the First Amendment expressly says government has no jurisdiction over religion. And then the Pope's going to come here and lecture us on carbon taxes and the rest of it. It is simply outrageous. I'll tell you one thing. After being gone 2 weeks and not being under bright lights, it is torturous. You know, we may have to get a lighting expert in here where we can turn up the irises and turn down the lights, because I realize that it just kills my thinking process to be in here underneath these lights this bright. I mean, I'll have to get used to it, but no wonder I get in such a bad mood every day by the third hour. because it's like being interrogated. But I digress, ladies and gentlemen. It is teleprompter free slash radio slash TV. So we will be going over Donald Trump, the good, the bad, and the ugly. What is he planning with the election? John Bowne's report that we aired at the start of the transmission, it's up on Infowars.com, Is Donald Trump a Wolf in Sheep's Clothing? Shows the Washington Post and others admitting a year ago that Donald Trump was in conversations and consultations with his, quote, good friends, the Clintons, about should he run as a Republican, something Bill Clinton encouraged him to do. Zero Hedge has asked the same question. Is Trump the Democrat wolf in GOP clothing? Well, I know the Clintons love him. But see, they know that we're so desperate to hear somebody tell the truth about political correctness or anchor babies or open borders or NAFTA or GATT or scores of other issues that we want straight talk. We're starving for it. We're like a man or woman in the Sahara dying of thirst. And so we hear the truth, and we want to support it. We want to defend it. I do as well. But the only way to defeat a moral, strong, popular opposition to oppression, to despotism, to social engineering, to tyranny, is to lead the opposition. But one thing's for sure, we're going to find out about Donald Trump. And as I said earlier, if Donald Trump betrays the American people and drops out of the race when he's in the lead, like Ross Perot did or something else, this country's a lot different than it was in 1992, 1993. And he's going to face serious repercussions. The only question is, are those repercussions going to be greater than the possible blackmail that he's under, that if he doesn't play ball, they're going to indict him? And believe me, Donald Trump is certainly in a position where they can dig something up on him. Because as I've said, I'm not even saying he's corrupt. The way the laws are written in this country, they can indict anybody they want, whenever they want. So that's all coming up. But while we're busy focused on Donald Trump, here's just a smattering of the headlines here. Lois Lerner emails released. She exclaimed in emails, Lincoln should have let the South go, and talks about how Texas is her enemy. And I've told you, there's this weird fantasy land that they're Lincoln and they're going to destroy the South and Texas is the main enemy and we all ride horses to work and hate big government and are bitter clingers. I mean, the average Texan, I've been all over the country many times, is just as sophisticated as anybody in San Francisco or New York City. In fact, in my experience, are more sophisticated when you get into management level stuff. That's why so many multinational corporations are based here. But there's just some weird fiction stereotype that we've all got outhouses. And again, I mean, when I'm in Europe, people ask me, do you ride a horse to work? No, we just have out of the top 10 cities, what is it, 6 of the top 10? I mean, NASA's based here. I don't know what you're talking about. But it's all this bizarre obsession with destroying Texas, defeating Texas, bringing down Texas, because they hate anybody they think is macho and tough. They want to break your will. They want to make you submit and go, I'm sorry. I'm sorry. I'm racist. I'm sorry for saying all lives matter. I'm bad. And so there's this archetypal image in the globalists who want to conquer America that if they can just bring down Texas, why they've got the whole thing won. And when I've gotten around leftists in other countries, other cities, they hear Texas and they recoil like they have encountered the devil or something. It's just distorted, ignorant weirdos. And you got to remember, their supporters want to put gun owners in forced labor camps and want to ban the First Amendment and every other bizarre thing you can imagine, because they're a cult of dumb control freaks. And so they've got these straw men enemies. I mean, they go watch movies like Machete, where Don Johnson's a sheriff and is shooting pregnant Hispanic women in the belly. There's not one documented case of anything like that. There's a fiction that everybody's down there shooting illegals. No, it's the coyotes and the Mexican police that are burying those mass graves. There's a documentary out on it that just won Sundance that goes over all of it, shot in Mexico. It's just the war on reality. Okay, I just read one headline. Here's some of the others. Republican-led Senate refuses to defund Planned Parenthood. U.S. Defense Intelligence Agency head. It was a willful decision by America to support an insurgency that had Salafist Al-Qaeda and the Muslim Brotherhood in it. Oregon State Police collecting data on gun sellers. Tensions flare in Ferguson on police shooting anniversary. Brown's friend gets shot up reportedly shooting at police. All this and more coming up. Coming up, mysterious fungus killing snakes in at least 9 states. And that ties into EPA crew accidentally turns major river orange, releasing now 3 million gallons. It was 1 million gallons of incredibly toxic arsenic cyanide-laced mining debris. You know, most of the time these so-called cleanups cause bigger problems than they solve. I'm going to tie that into the situation that we've been seeing more and more research on, that fungus is causing a lot of forms of cancer. We know it's killing a lot of the bats, so I'll cover that some in the second hour. We're going to get into tensions flaring in Ferguson on police shooting anniversary. I'm tempted to send our reporters back up there. But one of Mr. Brown's friends, who was one of the witnesses testifying to what everybody else said wasn't true, got shot reportedly after shooting at police. And things are degenerating fast. And everyone but Hillary is having Black Lives Matter come and shut down their campaign events. So the Soros group is doing a good job turning Americans against each other and then making legitimate protest against police brutality look stupid. So I'll be getting into that as well. But I want to take your calls on the Trump situation starting in the next segment. I've got some clips from the debates. I also have Senator Paul saying he's a fake conservative. Which, if you judge Donald Trump by most of his past activities, that's true. He's been pro-abortion. He's been pro-immigration. But he says of workers, which I agree with, if they're skilled workers, we need them. And he's been a huge Democrat supporter, more than a Republican supporter. That said, he has been a critic of vaccines for more than a decade and linked it to autism and said he doesn't take vaccines, something I like about Trump. And I think Trump has to be given the benefit of the doubt. If Senator Paul, who I'm a big supporter of, was as aggressive and hardcore as Trump and wasn't listening to his advisors from the Republican Party that have successfully gelded, castrated the Republican Party, he would be way out front. Now, there's no doubt, and we showed the article earlier, that Trump has had multiple phone conversations with the Clintons about whether he should run for office or not. And the Clintons, Bill Clinton specifically said, please do it as a Republican. We're talking about running the most important country in the world that is the linchpin of the global empire. Would they engage in this type of operation to take control of the Republican field and scuttle it? Absolutely. But Trump could really want to be president and want the power for himself. There's such a thing as divide and conquer, but there's also a thing called separation of powers, where because the elite themselves are divided and fighting over power, a lot of times historically they end up not being able to finish their plans. That's why we have a divide and conquer over government. The founders used that against government itself. We want gridlock so we don't get a man on a white horse. In fact, they just found one of the headlines from the Washington Post about the Clintons and Trump basically wargaming things. So I'm going to give Trump, the benefit of the doubt. Because what he's saying against political correctness, against open borders, is common sense. It's not racist. And if they can demonize that idea, then they can demonize the truth. And he talks about having enthusiasm, cutting taxes by 40%. Things like that would create one of the biggest booms this country's ever seen. And I hope people like Donald Trump are real. But I want to get your take on the situation. Here's the toll-free number, 800-259-9231, 800-259-9231. But I just want to say this right now. And I've said it twice, I'll say it again today, the third time. If Donald Trump engages in any hanky-panky or any double-dealing, I don't care how slick he is and how many fancy East Coast degrees he's got, and how many casinos he owns. At this key juncture, he does this. He's going to be dirt in this country. He's going to immolate himself politically, burn himself to the ground. Ladies and gentlemen, Alex Jones here back live. This morning, I was in another county working on a very important story that I'm not at liberty to report on yet, and was approached by a gentleman who's actually well-known in intelligence agencies and who also had working under him a famous intelligence operative. I just wanted to give me his card and get in contact with me while I was working on a separate story. My life is like a James Bond movie. I'm not bragging. I was just remembering I had this card and that strange happening took place in a parking lot. And then separately, we were contacted by one of the most famous astronauts ever. And it's not Buzz Aldrin who's been on the show. It's not some of the other people. It's a very famous astronaut from the old space program and the newer space program. I'll leave it at that. And let's just say this. I've entered the Twilight Zone. There I was flying back from Rome yesterday on a Dreamliner. And the windows have chemicals in them where you can lighten them or darken them. And they have this beautiful blue when they're dark. And then you could hit the button and lighten it. And I was up at 33,000 feet looking at the curvature of the Earth, up in the edge of the Earth's atmosphere, and just thinking about how fantastical reality is. By the way, that astronaut's coming on tomorrow. Did I mention that? They want to come on. And I was just thinking, as I've said many times, but I want to say it again, we will break free from the globalist tyranny the minute we get outside their control box and just realize that we're in a world of wonder. That we are residents of Wonder World. And I was down in San Marcos this morning. And after I pulled out of this parking lot from doing an investigation, and I was driving down the road and I looked up on the name of the street, I'm not kidding, and it was Wonder World Street. And I'd just been thinking last night on the plane that I was going to shoot a special report called Wonder World. And then I'm down there on another story, and a guy from Iran-Contra pops out in the parking lot. And then I get here, and they're like, yeah, this astronaut contacted us. He wants to come on and talk about something big, but doesn't want to talk about it till he's on the show. And it just gets weirder and weirder and weirder by the moment. But I guess when you open up to the universe and open up like the mind of a child, The universe opens up to you. And the globalists, the social engineers, the controllers of the public mind, they know this, and everything they do is to shutter the mind so that you don't realize how truly amazing things are. I want to go to Mike, John, Rick, Ben, and many others. The toll-free number to join us is 800-259-9231. We're going to be talking about Donald Trump and the 2016 election. And what do you do when somebody is saying things that are true, saying things nobody else will say? You got to defend him because you got to defend those ideas. But then he's hanging out with the Clintons. He's giving them money. We've seen this before. And you know you got good candidates like Rand Paul and Ted Cruz. So I got to say, at a gut level, Rand Paul, I trust 99%. Ted Cruz, 95%. Donald Trump, about 49%. But in my gut, I feel like I've just got to give him the benefit of the doubt, because I believe if he gets enough support, he will force the other Republicans to become more populist and more nationalist. I mean, that is the good news, that he is bringing up the topics they don't want discussed. He's bringing up the vaccines, the open borders, the devalued dollar. He says he doesn't want war with Putin. And maybe, just maybe, Donald Trump really wants to be somebody, not just some casino owner and some real estate owner. Because at the end of the day, folks, when you got a bunch of money and a bunch of power, so I've talked to a lot of people, Forbes is way down the list. Trump is way down the list on the Forbes list. I've talked to folks with more money than Donald Trump, and they say it's completely empty. You'd think it's completely fulfilling. That's why they all try to get into politics or influence things, whether it's for good or bad. And maybe, just maybe, Donald Trump's figured that out now and not when he's 85 years old and getting ready to die, like a lot of them do. Because I'll tell you right now, at 41 years, about to be 42, at 41 years old, I'm the same as I was when I was 18. I've always cared about what's honorable. And it's not because I'm some great, good, wonderful, perfect person on a proverbial platform, high horse. I instinctively know people come and go. I've got a connection to everybody before me and everybody coming up in the future. I want humanity to be successful. I want us to survive. I want us to thrive. I'm a fan of humanity. I believe in innovation. And I don't want to devalue human life, because if we devalue human life, we'll devalue everything else as well. So what do you think about Donald Trump? And then, of course, I'm just going to say this every day, because now is the season that folks actually care. I've made films about it. I've written books about it. I've covered it for 20 years. This is something I was informed of when I first got on air. A lot of times you'll hear me say I've covered it for 15, or I've covered it for 18, or I've covered it for 10. I've learned a lot in the process of every day focusing on what's happening in the world and talking to all these experts and all these guests. And reading your letters and books and the information you send in and your phone calls. I've been focused on this. But on the subject of them harvesting babies and implanting their brains in mice and pigs and cows and splicing them with spiders and jellyfish and you name it, I've known about that since day one, because it's in scientific publications that they were cloning human embryos 50 years ago, probably earlier. They've been splicing humans with everything under the sun so they don't have rights. Then they grow these humanoids up in these laboratories, inside, not artificial wombs, but inside cows and inside pigs. And now they've reportedly got artificial wombs where they are growing them in, and there's stocks trading on this stuff. And I sit here talking to the public like they're a bunch of kids, and I'm telling them the Atlantic Ocean exists. You're like, really? Show me the Atlantic Ocean. And just because you deny the Atlantic Ocean exists doesn't mean it's not there. And it's key. And I keep saying this every day. I'll say it again and then go to your calls. If the public understands that they're selling baby parts and keeping babies alive to harvest their organs and implanting their brains in mice, yes, they're giving mice human brains. That was out 20 years ago. They're putting human brains in roaches, too. They use rats, they use mice, they use roaches. They're hooking brains up to computer chips. I mean, it's, you name it, they're doing it. And that's what we know about. How do you get the public to understand that's only the tip of the iceberg? It's admitted the geoengineering. I turned my phone off. I was sleeping part of the way on the way back. I woke up. We're flying over Canada, over the pole from Europe. And I see a jet flying about, you rarely see this at 33,000, 35,000 feet. Maybe flying 2,000 yards away. I mean, it's close, big, flying the other direction. And it had ice crystals forming behind it. And by the time I fumbled and turned my phone on, because we were flying on the same path, just the other direction, they were gone. I was watching the ice crystals disappear in front of me as we flew by the jet. A, they were forming at high altitudes like they're supposed to. B, it was dissipating within 30 seconds. That's the condensation trail we all grew up with. And see, there's an example. When you're awake, everything is incredible because you see the propaganda, you see the manipulation, you see the mysteries, you wonder what else is going on, and what am I getting at? It's Manhattan Projects in top of Manhattan Projects. It's a Manhattan Project with the human cloning they've kept quasi-secret. It's a Manhattan Project squared with the chemtrailing, the geoengineering, which is admittedly going on, but again, all the specifics are classified. And it's like, what are they doing? Underground bases, clones, spraying stuff in the atmosphere, aborting half the black people? And I can't get white people, black people, nobody. I'm like, they're killing half of you. I'm sorry, some cop shot one of you, and you're making it a big deal. George Soros is telling you to focus on this because it's divide and conquer. The mainstream media is pushing it. Can't we come together and say, what are you spraying? What are you doing to the crops? What are you feeding us? There's over 1,000 crops in the U.S., of corn that are pharmacological crops. Over 1,000 approved. I'll give you one example. They got them that grow hepatitis. They got them that grow HIV. I'll never forget, I was on a coast-to-coast AM show with one of their weekend hosts. I don't get the name wrong. Ian Punnett? I think that was his name. Pretty nice guy. It's like 10 years ago. And he goes, give me an example of pharmacological crops. So I pulled up in front of me, AP, a couple years old then, Protegen, live HIV corn planted in Texas that grows HIV for an experimental HIV vaccine. And he said, there's no way they have corn that grows HIV. And then he looked it up and he goes, oh, my God, it's true. And see, I said I'd go to your calls and I will. But that's an example of just we're not in Kansas anymore. It's worse than we know. It's always, 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 always. People accuse me of exaggerating. Man, I wish that was true. It's almost always worse than I thought. And all I know is I get contacted by a lot of high-level government people over the years, generals, astronauts, colonels, famous people. You hear some of them on the air. CIA whistleblowers, foreign government leaders, the head of the German intelligence agency, Andres von Bülow, the number three in the Japanese government's been on. I'm not bragging. I'm telling you, why is this show so special? This is not rocket science. This is all admitted. And it's just the fact that I and our audience and our guest care and other people don't. They really think the movies and sex and beer is everything, or football games. And look, I'm not saying movies, sex, and beer are something bad. It's just that at the end of the day, There's bigger things on this planet. Our species just started flying with airplanes 100 years ago, with hot air balloons 500 years ago. The helicopter was invented 80-something years ago. We've now got space bases. We've now got the DNA cracked of humans, and we're not being given access to it. We're told, sit down and shut up while they're cloning humans crossed with animals. And they got the nerve to come out and say, first, Planned Parenthood does not sell body parts. Okay, we do, but we don't make money. Okay, those are edited videos. So they release 5-hour, 10-hour, 3-hour videos. They're all out there. 5-hour one was put out today. It's on InfoWars with what they're doing. And so as interesting as Donald Trump is, it's all a facade. And by facade, Donald Trump's playing along with it. Most of these people are compartmentalized. It's the scientific technological elite that Eisenhower talked about that's in control of the military-industrial complex that's running this whole operation. And as far as I'm concerned, they're space aliens. And again, I want to be clear. I'm not saying they are literal green men from Mars or from Pluto or from the moon or from Arctic bases or whatever. The globalists are a guild of psychopath, super genius control freaks who say in their own literature they believe they're another species and envision discovering DNA 160-something years ago. And guess what? They've done it. So I give it to them. They have built a breakaway civilization. What we know is so fantastic, I can't even imagine what they're really up to. And they're already creating aliens on this planet. That's 100% fact. When you cross a human with a pig, or a human with a spider, or a goat with a spider, or a human with a cow, you have created something alien that did not exist and was not of this world. You're now playing God. And when you start harvesting organs and doing all that, you've now dehumanized yourself. I'm going to go to break, come right back with your calls. We'll do Donald Trump right through the next hour, and I'll get to all this other news, the mystery fungus is killing things, and the rest of it. That's what I'm really worried about, is what you see in the movie Interstellar, which is what the globalists actually talk about, is the type of bioweapon you'd release would be like a super fungus that eats all the nitrogen out of the atmosphere, or stuff like that. And it's only a matter of time. I mean, they're setting up a world-ending event, as best I can tell. I'm going to skip this network break to gain more time. I'm going to stop after that. Super Male Vitality is back. You help fund our operation with these high-quality plant extract concentrates. And the reason Super Male and Super Female Vitality get such rave reviews is because you take concentrated, organic, wet herbs, not dry, sitting in a warehouse for 5 years, and then you concentrate them. That's why it's like syrup. And you get a major kick in the pants. And I mean a kick in the pants. Energy, stamina, vitality, libido. Regardless, you're helping fund the operation. Try it. We have a 99% review rate by major third-party sites. Let me give you some of the reviews. Comments about Super Male Vitality. I take 2 full droplets when I first get to work. I don't take any more for the rest of the day. I've stopped experiencing the mid-afternoon crash after my first week of regular use. I've also been more focused and alert, being one who knows the truth about the country situation. It's been hard to stay focused and not get worn down. But this product has restored my lost energy and helped me be more upbeat. And that's by Burleson, Texas, 2A Forever. And again, this doesn't copy testosterone or other hormones. From the research, according to Group and others, it gets the glands pumping the way they're supposed to. All these chemicals in the food and water are on record, White House science are, to suppress our normal activity. Here's another one by Beator Sheenhund in Kentucky. Supermel Vitality uses in conjunction with X2 Nation Iodine keeps me extremely focused, energetic, and alert, often allowing me to run rings around coworkers, decades my junior in a strenuous job. Strenuous. Yes, I would recommend this to a friend. 5.0 review on that one. And there's more. Andy and Zen Christopherin, Milwaukee, Wisconsin, mixed with some ultra-filtered water, and it goes down tasteless. I like to chase it with my Supermel Vitality, talking about X2, for the sweet aftertaste. It has noticeable effects within a week. Clarity and awareness increase without any unnecessary energy buzz. 5.0. I'm going to stop reading. Thousands of reviews on Just X2 and Supermel Vitality. Both are now back in stock. InfoWarsLife.com or 888-253-3139. 888-253-3139. We do have some other specials on the site. You can check those out for yourself at InfoWarsLife.com. InfoWarsStore.com is the blanket umbrella shopping cart site. And this is a revolution in funding. We're not selling, you know, a DVD for $100 like PBS does to get you to donate, or a $50 donation for a coffee cup that costs them $1. And then they get taxpayer money on top of it. And I'm not bashing local PBS. I think they do some good sometimes compared to NPR. That's the devil in my view. But this is a hardcore operation that tells it like it is. And we're about 70% self-funded now. Still have some sponsorship. We could have all the sponsorship we want. But this way I can have total control over quality in-house. The network has their sponsors, and that's their issue. But we have ours. They have a lot of great sponsors as well. But when you hear us certify something, that means I've checked into it, I believe in it, and it's the very best product for the lowest price possible, because I don't believe in Reap What You Sow. I know it's real. There's a difference between believing and absolutely, at a cellular level, living that way. You could call it superstition, but it's beyond superstition. My cells want to help people. My gut wants to help people. My gut wants to help myself. When I hurt somebody, it's like I'm doing it to myself. That's why people that are vandalizing the genetic code of this planet, people playing God, the devilish miscreants, make me at a cellular level hate their guts. Okay, Donald Trump. Trump, the political hurricane, still rages on, but he's up in poll numbers in a new scientific poll. DrudgeReport.com is linked to the NBC News survey showing Trump went up after more incendiary comments. Yeah, people are sick of political correctness and being bullied. And the system knows that. That's why they always say, be nice, don't be incendiary, don't be aggressive in politics, you'll get ahead. And then they can select the most milquetoast wimp they want that they can destroy whenever they want. I mean, I'm not saying I like what Tiger Woods did. I'm not defending it. But if he'd have come out and said, it's my private life, if my wife wants to leave me, that's her issue. You know, it's probably not the best what I've done. I apologize to my family, but it's none of your business. This is nothing compared to robbing banks or politicians screwing us over. Stay out of your, you know, business that isn't yours. Tiger Woods would have been just fine. Instead, he bought into all the hype and what the media was saying about him, and everybody turned on him for hundreds of apologies. Oh, they said, you better apologize. And then when he did, they destroyed him. Well, now they want Donald Trump to apologize, talking about Megyn Kelly bleeding out of, you know, her eyes or whatever. Well, that's what he said about other people. And again, I'm not even defending Trump. When they build a straw man, whether he's good or bad, and then destroy him, they're destroying us, and they're destroying free speech. But Rand Paul says Trump is a fake conservative, and I want to play that clip right now. This is him on the news talking about the Donald and saying he's a fake conservative. And I think his track record shows he's not really fake. It's that he wasn't a conservative previously. Here it is.
Well, I don't think we should reward vulgarity, and I don't think vulgarity equates with insight. And so because you can shout and call people names and call someone stupid or call someone fat, is that really what we're going to make the decision on for who's going to be our nominee? You know, I came out of the Tea Party movement, and part of the Tea Party movement was that we were upset with fake conservatives and Republicans who truly weren't conservative, Republicans who were for Obamacare and Republicans who were for the bank bailouts. Well, that's Donald Trump. He's been for all of these liberal policies, and now because he can stand up and say vulgar things and he's a truth teller, well, the truth is, what is he for? I have no idea whether he's conservative. He really could be a liberal for all I'm concerned. I have no idea what his real philosophy is. other than that he is for promoting himself.
Overall, I think that's true. I think it's fair for Rand Paul to get tough and say that if he wants to win. But Rand is listening to the Republican wing that's telling him to not go after the open borders. And he's kind of been down the middle on this issue. He's voted against amnesty, but only because it wasn't transparent. It's not libertarian to bring in illegals and then give them everything free. Yes, we could have open borders if we didn't have any welfare. So, Rand, stop listening to your advisors. Act more like Donald Trump. I don't think it's vulgar to say, oh, I defeated him in a debate. They were bleeding all over the place. I use that analogy all the time. In a debate, I was beating the snot out of him. He was bleeding. He was melting down. I mean, I slaughtered Piers Morgan. Absolutely mopped the floor with him. That's why they declared it such a defeat for me. Because it was such a devastating victory. That's why they wouldn't dare invite me on anything. Got top ratings, number one news story in the country for a week. Why was it on every other show? Because I go in there and say, it's all fake, it's a matrix, it's bull. This is all garbage, they're funded by drug companies, mass suicide pills. This is all bull. So they cut the segment short. They panicked. They hit the ejection button. Your calls are 1 minute away.
Thank you,
Mike, John, Rick, Ben. All right, at least I'm a talk show host that likes to talk. Most talk show hosts lean on the callers and lean on clips and don't even want to be on air. Believe me, I've been around them. Not me. My problem is I want to work too hard. I want to fight too hard. That's because I'm not a quitter. I'm not a loser. And I don't think I'm exceptional, other than the fact that their conditioning doesn't work on me. We're taking your phone calls. Said I'd go to them last hour. I will now in this hour. Talk about everything Donald Trump. Is he a Trojan horse? Is he a shill? Is Rand Paul right that he's a fake conservative? Well, I don't think it matters now in this phase because he now is the champion of conservative national populism. Metaphysically, he's now in that office, and he better not screw people over. He better not back down. He better not now flip-flop and throw it to Hillary, who we know he's been meeting with. What's your take on this whole situation? What do you see coming? What do you see unfolding? Mike in Arizona, thanks for holding. You're on the air worldwide.
Hey, Alex. Glad to have you back.
Welcome.
Just wanted to say I'm glad to hear you say that you want to give Trump the benefit of the doubt. I feel the same. I want to give him the benefit of the doubt. I was at the rally he had here a few weeks ago, and, you know, there were 15,000 people there, lots of patriots, lots of InfoWars fans. And, you know, like on the issues of him, you know, used to be for abortion and whatnot, you know, just like yourself, like you said, you've been involved in them in the past. Like myself, I used to believe in it, but thought it was about women's rights. But, you know, you come along on those issues once you start learning more and more about it.
Well, sure. So, and to be specific, I wasn't paying for them. I wasn't involved in that sense. Other than the fact that I knew it was going on and didn't do enough to stop it. And in a way, that's a coward's way. It's almost more cowardly what I did, kind of blind-eyeing it, than in there pushing for it. So let me be clear. It was very cowardly and bad and not good for my family name and low the way I was when I was, say, 18, 20 years old. And I repent of that. So when I criticize folks out there that have had abortions, I'm not doing it because I hate them individually. I'm doing it to warn them. Now, the people that know what it's really about and are pushing it and covering up and covering up what it's really all about, they are the scum of the earth. Go ahead. Sorry.
No, I feel the same way. I mean, when we were younger, for myself personally, I thought it was really about women's rights. You know, women were being held down. But you learn, you know, once you learn about Margaret Sanger and eugenics, that this isn't it, and that feminism was actually hijacked by the Rockefellers because only half the people were being taxed, you know, to break up the family.
They all admit it. They've all written the books on it. In fact, it was women's suffrage was hijacked. But yes, then turned into modern feminism.
Well, I think he might have come along on those issues. And like myself, in the 90s, I used to be a Democrat. But, you know, you learn more and you come along on issues. And what big businessman doesn't want to buy power and influence? So, you know.
Well, it's our political system and it's legal right now. So I think saying that he's given campaign contributions to both sides isn't overall a completely honest attack because They're playing on the ignorance of the public, not knowing that major corporations always have to give to both sides, whether it's the Koch brothers or you name it. My problem is he's hooked in with casinos, very seedy. He is also hangs out with the Clintons previously, plays golf with them, and ran it by Bill Clinton should he run for president as a Republican. And Bill Clinton said, I think that's a great idea, Donald. So you add that together. I'm just saying, let's watch him. Let's see what he's doing. He's meant to be put in there by the Clintons. I'm not saying he's consciously doing this to tear the Republican Party apart. Not that the Republican Party is perfect. It's certainly bad. But it's meant to obscure the good movement within the Republican Party. Good to hear from you, Mike. Let's talk to John, Rick, Ben, and many others. Straight ahead on the other side, toll-free number to join us, 800-259-9231. Coming to you from deep in the heart of Texas, Austin, I'm Alex Jones. This is the InfoWar. All right, I've been pontificating for an hour on Donald Trump and other issues. And yes, he's a distraction, but he's a distraction that's become real. He is dominating in the polls. A new NBC poll that's up on drudgereport.com is out, and it shows what other polls show. Since the debates, he went up even higher. The more the mainstream media attacks him, the more the people support him, including a lot of Democrats. And that's what I told Politico about 4 years ago when Rand Paul got into the Senate. They called up and they said, why can't we bring down Rand Paul? And I said, because you're discredited. And I said, if you start endorsing him, that will bring him down. But you're so arrogant, you won't do that. And so that's how discredited Congress is with an 8% approval rating. That's how discredited establishment dinosaur media is. And now we have this cult of personality that hangs out with the Clintons, who gets Bill Clinton's blessing, the Washington Post reports last year, to get ready to run for the Republican nomination. And I don't know if Ross Perot was a shill or not. I know he dropped out when he was 5 points ahead of George H.W. Bush and Bill Clinton. He was about 5 points ahead of each one of them. Some showed 10 points ahead. And then he said, my family has been threatened. I am stepping down. Now, I warned you about NAFTA and GATT. I told you everything was going to happen, and I'm done. I'm retiring. Goodbye. So what is going to happen if that unfolds? That is a big question. What are you going to do when Donald Trump flip-flops? And see, the media will be attacking him on legitimate issues, on things he said that are truthful, like we shouldn't pay for anchor babies, we shouldn't have open borders, we should make America strong again, we should cut taxes. So you'll want to defend him because what he's saying is legitimate. Now, I'm giving him the benefit of the doubt, and I'm not just doing that because mainline libertarians and conservatives overwhelmingly like him. I'm doing it because he's not really run for office before. He's done some good things 10 years ago, speaking out against vaccines, speaking out against so-called free trade, speaking out against a lot of things, and telling the truth. So I'm not sure. I'm thinking maybe he really does want to save this country. Maybe he wants to really be the big man and not just a real estate and casino owner. I don't know. But regardless, he's the front runner. And people out there that love him aren't going to listen to us if we just say, oh, he's horrible, oh, he's a shill, oh, he's a government agent. They're only going to listen to us if we're legitimate and say, okay, we'll give him benefit of the doubt, but let's all watch out. And let's all appreciate Rand Paul, who's talked about the NSA spying and funding Al-Qaeda and ISIS and talked about all these other issues, who's being attacked and demonized because they know he's the real deal. Notice he didn't support the TPP. Ted Cruz did. People like Rick Perry are for forced Gardasil inoculations. Can't support him. 800-259-9231. Then we're going to go into the control room studio and talk to Joe Jennings, Anthony Gucciardi, and others and get their take on the situation. But now let's go through your calls here pretty quick. John in Wyoming, you're on the air. Go ahead.
Welcome back, Alex.
Thank you, brother.
I wanted to give you a suggestion. If you get a chance to interview Donald Trump or Ted Cruz or Rand Paul, asking this one question, which will determine whose side they're on. Ask them, if you are elected president, do you promise now you will never appoint any past or present member of the CFR to any cabinet-level position or any judgeship anywhere in the country? And if they won't answer yes to that, then they're on the other side. It's really that clear-cut and simple.
Well, sure, I've never criticized the Catholic Church because a lot of Catholics I know are great people, and I saw the Catholic Church being against abortion. What do you do when the Pope is endorsing socialism, endorsing communism, endorsing open borders, involved in our internal politics, pushing carbon taxes, calling for planetary regimes? What do you do? How do you respond to that?
Well, it's hard to do because I believe, and there are a few other people who believe this too, that this is the anti-pope. This is the man who was sent by the devil to destroy the Catholic Church. I was in the Catholic Church for over 20 years, and I got out when all of this stuff, long before this Pope Francis came about, I got out whenever we had a priest down in Dickinson, Texas, trying to tell us, he was talking about the schism, which occurred in 1054 A.D., and then he said, well, and since that time, many a Greek Orthodox priest has led millions of their parishioners into hell. So he was implying, basically, that if you're not a member of his church, you're going to hell, which is an obvious lie, because Jesus decides where we go, not some idiot priest. But what I think here, we need to ask these people, whether it's Donald Trump or Rand Paul or Ted Cruz, if you are elected president, will you promise right now you will never appoint any past or present members of the CFR to any cabinet post or to any judgeship?
You know, that's a great idea. We should get a coalition or group together and just ask Trump to sign a pledge to try to repeal NAFTA and GATT. To not have members of the Council on Foreign Relations or Trilateral Commission. Basically, we should ask Trump to sign on to the Texas Republican campaign platform. Because if you look at the Republican platform of Texas, voted in by the Republican Party, it sounds like something the John Birch Society wrote. And I think that's the answer, is to get him to pledge on a new contract on America that he will actually stand on and sign his name to, and then if that happens, he'll be in a lot of trouble. What do you think is going to happen to Trump, though, if he scuttles this Republican opposition to the Clintons? What do you think is going to happen to Trump's name? I mean, I think he realizes that his name is going to be anathema.
Well, what I'm worried about is if he is the nominee, that they're going to arrange for a convenient little accident for him, as they did for JFK back on November 22nd, 1963. That's the way they work. Remember when E. Howard Hunt was about to be paid all kinds of hush money over the JFK assassination, his wife went to pick up the money. It was over, $2 million worth. And as she was flying back home while the plane was flying over, it was a commercial airliner flying over southern Illinois, it mysteriously blew up in the sky, scattering a couple of $1 million worth of currency all over the landscape.
That's right. People forget about that. God bless you. Great call from John. I'm going to go to Rick in a moment. But we forget the globalists to keep power didn't just kill JFK or didn't just kill other people. They blew up a whole bunch of aircraft. They killed a lot of House members, a lot of senators, a lot of governors. Now they just indict you. And so we're entering a very, very serious time right now. Let's go to Rick in Missouri, listening on KCXL 1140 AM. You're on the air, Rick. Thanks for calling in.
Hey, welcome back, Alex. How you doing today, buddy?
Good, brother. Thanks for calling. What's your take on Trumpy?
Well, listen, I just wanted to make a quick comment regarding Trump and Ron Paul and stuff, and then I'll hang up so other people can, have more airtime on your great show. But listen, what do you think of the tag team between like Trump and Rand Paul as far as president, vice president, or them vice versa? I think it'd be a 1-2 punch that this United States has never seen.
That would be a great ticket, and we've had presidential candidates attack each other before and then end up being on the same ticket. But I tell you, I don't see that happening because Trump's the type that would want a weak second to him, kind of like George Herbert Walker Bush had Dan Quayle. That would be a great ticket because I think people would trust that ticket, and Rand Paul has a lot of appeal to more sensible liberals that are anti-war, anti-foreign aid. But that would be a great ticket. What do you think is going to happen to Trump, though, if he scuttles this election?
It's gonna ruin the name. I'll tell you, it's not a good deal. He needs to stand his ground and be truthful to the American people.
I hear you. And with all the dishonesty we've seen from politicians and all the corruption and all the dirty tricks and all the hanky-panky and shenanigans, I hear criticism from folks against people that don't trust Trump, and I don't think that's legitimate. I'm not saying people are bad who think Trump is a second coming and just are staking everything on him. But I don't think you're bad either if you don't trust him. I'm sitting back. I'm watching. We're going to go to break here in a moment. But first, I want to go to Anthony Gucciardi for a moment, come back with him, and then to Joe Jennings, and then back to your calls. But I wanted to, as we go to break, Anthony, what's your gut level feel on Trump?
Well, you know, I watch the Republican debates, and I usually don't. There's a reason this one got 24 million viewers. It's because people are tired of the, I will be a strong leader. They want no PC, no BS, and that's what Trump brings, regardless of what he ultimately does. People think it's a breath of fresh air. When Megyn Kelly asked him that question about some things he said about Rosie O'Donnell and tried to corner him in with his liberal perspective of, you said something bad about a woman, he said, yeah, who cares? You know, I'll say the same thing about a man if they're coming up against me. And people love that.
Stay there. I want to come back and have you elaborate on that. But that's it. I mean, look, a woman's on TV. She's a political anchor. She's in a man's world, to use a politically incorrect term. I'm all for women being in power positions. But then don't jump back across the line and go, I'm a woman, so you can't criticize me or disagree with me. It's like, you don't support Hillary, you hate women. No, I hate criminal, dirtbag, scum, New World Order trash. All right, I want to go back to your phone calls. John in Florida, Ben in Missouri, Tom in New York, Walt in Michigan, James in Colorado, and others. We will do that, but I'm talking to my crew and political and, of course, health writer Anthony Gucciardi. We got Joe Jennings, who helps run the show. And Joe's got his political view on the situation as well. I mean, I'm really just trying to hear from people out there about what they think about Donald Trump. And if he just joined us, you'd have to be hiding in a cave to not know he's leading the Republicans. The more incendiary he gets, the higher he goes in polls. That just validates everything I've been telling people. Stop being apologetic. Stop being cowardly. I'm not saying our listeners have been, but to the general public, stop apologizing for everything. I've got a video coming up in the next hour of black racist demonstrators in Southeast Texas where this black lady, I think, killed herself in the cell. She talked about suicide, said she was going to commit suicide, flips out when the cop pulls her over. They might have killed her, say 10% chance. Cops do that sometimes. They're bad cops. And then these black racists show up that sound as bad or worse than any white racist I've ever heard. And there's these white people going, I'm sorry, I'm white. I have black friends. I'm sorry. They're like, shut up, white. You need to die, period. All whites are bad. I mean, this is the craziness being put out that the mainstream media helps exacerbate. There it is, Sandra Bland protest. All white people should be killed. Breitbart, Texas. And this woman is so emboldened and arrogant because of political correctness. In fact, I want to get that lady on the show if we can do it. She does cuss a lot. Because I'm going to tell her, okay, can we not abort the black babies? Or can we shut up, racist? Because, see, that's not the script being fed by Al Sharpton and the media. It's just totally, totally crazy. But I digress to the dumbing down of society. Before we go back to your calls, Anthony, finishing up your points on Trump. Look, this guy's a playboy. He's a party animal. My big concern is I think he's blackmailable big time. He's involved in the casino business. That's as dirty a business as they come. I don't have a good gut feeling about Trump overall. Him specifically, I don't have a bad gut feeling, but the whole process just feels like a setup. But at the same time, you got to defend him because what he's saying is true. So how do you separate that dichotomy from what he's saying is true? So they're attacking what he's saying, so you got to defend it because what he's saying is true. But at the same time, I've got some concerns. What's your take on that?
I think it's interesting to note that all of these pundits and everything say, oh, well, he's breaking the rules of politics. He's unprofessional. He's not a true politician. Well, those are rules that they set at some point in time, and those are rules that people actually hate. And as I mentioned, you know, 24 million viewers on the debate, the most viewed non-sports event on cable ever. Fox News should be worshiping Trump for doing so. At the same time, it's like, yes, he is blackmailable. Yes, also it's a cost-benefit analysis. Is the Hillary campaign going to actually pay him off more money to side with them? But he's going and being real, and that's what people like. People like
reality. So that's the message, is people want genuine. Even if he's not really genuine, the appearance of genuine is king.
Yeah, exactly. And he's going on air, and Megyn Kelly, obviously the host who was from Fox News hosting the debate, was throwing these super, super challenging questions at him, trying to hit him with PC crap. Like, oh, you hate women. You know, how could you say this about these immigrants and everything like that? And he's not cowering and playing by the political ball game and saying, I'm so sorry, I never meant to say that. Then he would lose. Ratings would drop instantly. So they could try and blackmail him with some stuff. But if he's smart, which it appears he is, he plays it off as, hey, I don't care. I'm real. We all say things. You know, what's mattering, the real issue is that this country is in the toilet.
That's right. And they've dumbed the debate down so much that, again, I saw an article in InfoWars a few days ago where at major universities they're having slap a straight white male day. And it actually says go out and slap straight white males. I mean, it's total discrimination. It's total bizarro cult-like Heaven's Gate weirdo behavior. And then we just sit here with these totalitarians going, slap a straight white male today. Well, go ahead and slap me. I'm going to break your nose. Go ahead. Then it would be a hate crime, though. All I did was come up and slap him because he's a white male and he knocked my teeth out. I mean, it's just, and it's all these chicken neck little white wimps that are leading the whole thing. Funded by George Soros, going to Ferguson, chanting deck the halls with dead cops. And now, reportedly, one of these loons just shot at some cops, so they got shot, and that's called racism. America doesn't want globalism. We don't want a nanny state. We don't want to be dominated and told how to talk and what to do. I don't care what color you are. People are sick of it. They want change. And we saw Obama served up on a silver platter as the next messiah by the mainstream media. This time, they're all demonizing Trump. And folks are responding by supporting him even more. That shows you the mainstream media doesn't have the power they used to. And all the numbers show that. I want to go back to the crew in the control room, then back to the callers, John, Walt, and others that are holding. I wanted to go to Joe Jennings. Joe, what is your view overall on Donald Trump? What's your take?
Alex, why does the country need a megalomaniacal, narcissistic bully to pull it out of the rut? That's just not what America's about.
Well, I mean, Napoleon helped.
Well, yeah, Napoleon helped. Look where it got him.
There was another guy that was pretty confident in Germany.
Yeah, he did a good job. Pretty good on population control, too.
Well, you talk about killing Germans. He got 20 million Germans killed.
Oh, yeah. I can't believe what Trump is saying. I just can't believe that would be a good choice for the country. Yeah, okay, yeah, screw everybody. You know, I'm Donald Trump and we're the U.S. and who cares? I just don't think that's the way we should be going.
But we're being dominated by the bullies of political correctness. Don't you see, though, that and I'm not disagreeing with you, Joe, overall, no. People's response is they want somebody to throw it back in the face of the establishment. The problem is he comes out of that very establishment as a very slick salesman with a lot of charisma. And so we have to debate his providence and if he's for real. I think he could be for real. I'm not saying he is. I think he could actually want to be president, actually want to save the country. There have been a lot of leaders who were macho and arrogant, who were not evil, who were able to pull countries out of a rut by having confidence and giving people the perception of confidence. The problem is a lot of times they turn into men on white horses, like Napoleon Bonaparte. That's where we get the saying, he rode a white horse. So in comes, in rides the man on a white horse. Who do you think would be a worse president then, since you don't like Trump? Hillary Clinton or Donald Trump?
It's the best of both evils there. I mean, I they're both corporate shills. You know, neither of them can be trusted. A lot of people say, well, you know, Hillary's got a track record. She's been in government for 20 years. Yeah, that's what we need.
Yeah, committing crimes, more like 35. All right, Joe, great points. Let's go finally to Matt there in the control room studio. He made a really good point during the break and wanted to come on air. Repeat the point you made, because this is something I've basically said, but not as simply as you've said it, because the way you crystallize it is absolutely on target, and that's why the Clintons are on record encouraging Trump to run for the Republican nomination. Go ahead and make your point on that.
Hey there. So name recognition in politics, let's pretend here for a second, say that when I'm voting, I don't know anything about the policies or the legislature that some of the politicians have gone for, created, voted for, whatever. So in that instance, I would vote for the person who I'm most familiar with on the ballot. It's name recognition. That's a concept in politics, and it does really dictate a lot of polls and things like that.
That's right.
When people are polling, this is a great example. Donald Trump, he's very popular now. That could be the correlation you're seeing there. It could be that he's just so recognizable. Everybody has known who Donald Trump was for quite a long time, before he announced that he was running for the election, anything like that. So he doesn't have to cover any ground there. He's already well known. And then let's say he just drops out of the race. Well, then who's the next most well-known person?
That's right. He hogs all of the debate time to make sure it's all about Trump all the time, while destroying any name recognition for the other Republicans who don't have anywhere near any of them what Hillary Clinton's got. And then with the dumbed down public, you now ensure Hillary Clinton. That's right. That's why people don't trust Trump, is because if he betrays and if he drops out or if he can be destroyed, then it ensures Hillary Clinton is the next president of the United States, which, I'll be honest with people, it's going to give us a lot more ratings. I'm going to become a lot more successful if Hillary Clinton gets in than if a Republican gets in and people go halfway asleep. But I don't want her to get in because she's so dangerous, they'll complete the work of Obama and then it's game over. We'll never repeal Obamacare. We'll never control the borders. We'll never get out of any of this globalism. And so I don't sit here and gauge my show off of what'll be better for ratings. News Corp is going to make hundreds of millions of dollars more a year under a Hillary system. And that's why Rupert Murdoch has given 2-1 to Hillary's campaign. I mean, News Corp is behind Hillary for a reason. And so here I am convincing myself that Trump's bad news. People are desperate. They want to see a man on a white horse. They want to believe everything's okay. What he's saying's true. Let me ask you this, Matt, and then finish up any other points, because I cut you off. What does your gut tell you about Trump, and what do you think is going to happen to Trump if he drops out?
What does my gut tell me about Donald Trump?
No, I mean, what's your gut? I mean, you think he's a shill? You think he's great? I mean, separate from the name recognition point, that he is hogging all of that, and the media, even though they're attacking him, knows that they don't have any credibility. So the only way they can do it now is lend credibility to him by attacking him, knowing he's their shill. And now we're talking truly Machiavelli.
Yeah, I'd have to say Donald Trump is awesome. Not necessarily in a good way, not necessarily in a bad way. He just is a big personality. He, like we've seen on InfoWars, he's got some views that are great, like towards vaccines. But he's also got some other ideas that are controversial, and he's crashing through, and you just never know if he's going to make good on those promises. So he's a lot of talk. We'll see if he's all bite.
Is he all bark or is he all bite? We'll find out soon. And that's certainly true. Thank you, Matt. We will find out. Time will tell. And look, I've said this hundreds of times. Focusing only on a presidential race is part of the problem. We get 60% turnouts on average for presidential campaigns, 25% maybe for congressional type stuff. Local, even lower. And then you can argue, is voting even real? The point is, participation is good so that real ideas get injected into the process, in my view. And you see both political parties circling the wagons, demonizing the true Tea Party, because they know that movement is anti-New World Order, anti-globalist. So you see the kind of Tea Party-esque nationalistic candidates show up to eclipse Rand Paul and others. It's just what I would expect out of the New World Order. You know, I like Jesse Ventura. Not that I even agree with some of his politics, but I know he's a good guy. He's for real. And if he ran for third party, it would probably take Democrat and Republican votes away, would probably equal itself out. A Donald Trump running for third party wouldn't inject ideas like a Ventura would. It would take away from conservatives, from libertarians, with a cult following that would then get behind him and ensure Hillary would win as well. So see, this works on so many fronts. If he drops out, he hogs all the name recognition, Hillary wins. If he runs third party, unless he wins, it puts Hillary in. Any way you look at this, from any angle, unless he's for real and he stays in, this guy delivers it to the Clintons. Let's go to John in Florida. Thanks for holding, John. We'll go to Ben and others that are patiently holding.
Hello?
Yes, sir. Go ahead.
Oh, okay. Hey, thanks for taking my call, Alex.
Thank you.
Hey, you know, I got a totally different outlook on this than probably most people do.
That's what I'm looking for. Please don't call in and agree with me if you think something else.
Okay.
I want to hear it.
Okay. First, I got to tell you something that McCain is for, and then I'll tie that into Trump. Okay?
Okay.
McCain just came out, and he's for reinstating Glass-Steagall. Now, this is a globalist par excellence, okay? Glass-Steagall will bankrupt major money center banks overnight, okay? So this is this man's way of running for cover. He's running for cover now, man. Okay, that's the way I see it, okay? This monetary system is done. It's coming down. I do this for a living. I do have some knowledge of this. Now, how does this tie into Trump? If you notice the language that Trump is using, your leaders are stupid. Your leaders are bad negotiators. He is conditioning the American public for what is to come. And then, oh, it's just that they're stupid. Okay, no. They're criminals, okay? They are paid for and bought criminals. The majority of them are treasonous, okay? And they don't want to get lynched. This to me, there is not going to be any election. To me, from what I've seen, Alex, this country is over. When you let the president light up the White House in gay colors. Look, I got nothing against what people want to do in
the But it shows the focus is Heaven's Gate cult level, where he goes to foreign countries that are under Al-Qaeda terrorist attack, like Kenya, and says you need to have gays everywhere. I mean, it's like, since when did America become nothing but confetti shooting out the president's rear end?
Exactly. And now tie that in with how he's you know, just look at the coincidences here. He talks about the border. Oh, yeah, yeah. And then everybody's making fun of him. And then some woman gets killed. Now, you know what? The news media could have buried that, but they didn't, because they're going along with it. This is all part, to me,
No, I agree. In fact, it's funny you raised that, because I'll see something that makes me think, oh, my God, he's bad for sure. Then I'll see something that goes, oh, well, he might be okay, because I'm just trying to really be open-minded here and not just have my mind set on something. But when, I mean, there's illegals every day, you know, that are here committing crimes, arson, rape, murder, and then it's only on the local news. And then, yeah, that woman gets shot randomly on the pier, and then CNN led with it. And I was like, that's a gift to Trump. Even though they're demonizing him, they then hand him things. I don't know. It's let's shift gears, though, into the collapse. The elite are running to the bunkers. There's major military escalations that always are a prelude to economic collapse. The Chinese stock market's been plunging. Greece is in crisis. You've got 30-40% unemployment in most EU states. So much is happening right now, and you see all these pieces lining up. The Federal Reserve boom, many economists are saying, is coming to an end. I shoot a video report about total emergency alert, elites headed, you know, to the bunkers, and it gets millions of views. People are really, really resonating that something big is about to happen. Gerald Celente says he believes stock market crash will happen this winter. I don't know if it's going to happen then, because they've suspended the rules of economics to a certain extent, but undoubtedly the cascade of bubbles is coming to an end. And absolutely, Trump almost talks like he's some foreign leader, where he's like, your leaders are this, your leaders are that, your leaders are idiots. And you're right. No, our leaders are compromised, sold out to globalists, and part of a plan to bring down the world economy and on its back introduce the new planetary government. That's been admitted, with the Pope now calling for it. So we've reached this epic point, and maybe they're going to give us Trump as a strong man during the collapse to then bring in fascism. I mean, let me tell you, the Tea Party and conservatism and libertarianism is hyper sexy, hyper popular, hyper growing, but it can easily be twisted into a form of fascism. And just like the Democrats are a cult of communist wannabes led by fascists, I mean, they are a drooling, knuckle dragging cult that don't look anything like their predecessors, that were very good on many points. But the Republicans during this dumbing down can flip and metastasize into something just as nasty. And all I know is something big is about to happen. Get into the economic collapse from, I mean, you say you work in these financial areas. We have a lot of the top experts the world on, but it's not just our experts now. Sure, we were saying it first. It's a lot of other experts say the day of reckoning's coming. What do you think's really happening, John?
Well, what I think is happening is that you've reached complete debt saturation. The only way to introduce more money into the system is to create more debt. Well, you can't service that debt because there isn't enough taxes to go around to service it. So the bottom line is, they knew when they created this system of debt-based money that it would eventually self-destruct.
And we're now at that point.
Faster and faster and faster. Eventually, it's going to blow apart. They know this was going to happen. Okay? And this is all part of bringing in and consolidating it even further and further and further. Think about it, Alex. Who here can actually pay more in taxes? You cannot pay. I can't pay any more. I'm done, man. I have no more money to give these people, okay? But yet, in order to support a debt-based money system, you must garner taxes. And one guy put it this way. He said, look, we should just go ahead and print the money, because what is the purpose of all of this loaning when we're never going to pay it back? It's an infinite loan. They have no intentions of ever paying any of this back.
You're right. So, we've now reached the point of critical mass, and the only question is, what are we as individuals going to do to get ourselves ready, but also educate people around us, so when it goes belly up, they know that the free market didn't do this. Select mega banks who are exempt from the taxes, exempt from the regulations, they set this up. And on the back of this meltdown, they want to bring in even more control. Now is the key time to be spreading the word so people understand what is about to hit the fan. Great points. Appreciate your call, John. We're going to go to break. and come back with Ben, and then Walt, James, Christian, and many, many others that are patiently holding. This is a great discussion, a lot of great callers. This is exactly what I wanted to happen today, was to see, could hear some of our really smart listeners bring up different angles and other facets to this and not just hear me babble. I've got literally a couple hundred articles that are all very important. We're going to start covering those in the third hour, but interspersed with your phone calls, because through Donald Trump and the media's response and everything that's happening in the landscape, it gives us a bird's eye view, but also a close-up view into how the other systems are operating. I'll tell you this, it's not going to be Donald Trump that's going to save this country. It's going to be an awakening and a rediscovery of the principles that make great nations. And if you look at everything being pushed by the establishment that's stolen power, that's created a monopoly based on fiat debt, based on Federal Reserve fraud, based on derivatives counterfeiting, it all stands at odds with transparency, with prosperity, with everything that makes sense and that is good. We're just talking about Mike Huckabee surging in the polls, in the debates, coming from nowhere, very well spoken, says a lot of good things. But I think in the words of CJ back there, he's just good to make, he's just there to make the old folks feel good and think everything's going to be okay.
I've watched his show. It's like an episode of the Statler Brothers.
I tell you, it's social engineering writ large. People want to believe what they want to believe. Let's go back to your phone calls. Let's talk to Ben in Missouri. You're on the air, Ben. Go ahead.
Hey, Alex. Thanks for taking my call, and thanks for all your great products. I use almost all of them, and I'm really happy with all of them. My whole thing is that I just don't understand how anybody can support this guy, Trump. I mean, he's fake. He's obviously fake. He's as real as the caller Smitty that calls up your show. I mean, he stands up there as this beacon of crony capitalism and throws it all in our face and says, oh, let me tell you something. I took advantage of all these deals. And let me tell you, I'm very proud of this. I'm very proud of this. And it's disgusting. This guy is appealing to the public's goldfish-like attention span by saying all the right things and by being politically incorrect. Meanwhile, Rand Paul has dropped off the face of the earth. He's the one that everybody should be supporting just because he's saying all the right things the exact same way as Obama did in 2008. Is it really a fun thing to watch? Of course it is. For somebody who has a nihilistic view of things and wants to just be entertained while the whole country burns, yeah, go ahead and vote for Trump. But, you know, I wonder what everybody's opinion of him is going to be as far as electability is when he takes Jeb Bush as his VP, because it sure did seem like he really enjoyed standing next to him at the debate. That's pretty much all I've got. And thanks again for your products there, buddy.
Well, thank you, brother. Yeah, I didn't plug any of the products this hour. Supermel Vitality is now back in stock at InfoWarsLife.com. That's been sold out for, I guess, 3-4 weeks. Supermel Vitality is now back. Concentrated herbs that are known to boost vitality, stamina, libido, like nothing. I mean, folks that have tried, I'm not going to get into it. Just try it out for yourself, InfoWarsLife.com. Read the reviews, InfoWarsLife.com or 888-253-3139. And thank you all for your support. James in Colorado, you're up next. Go ahead.
Hey, what's up, Alex? You should consider getting a natural light in your studio. I have fluorescent light in every single room in my house. It's like mind control, basically. But as far as Trump, I don't know if I've coined the term, but a wolf in sheepdog's clothing, I think, is the good one. Because a lot of these people, like George Bush, to push small government, but then, of course, they're putting through the Patriot Act, global government. So it's kind of just party politics. And I think Rand Paul should attack him really on two issues, which is eminent domain, the fact that he's kicked so many people off of their private property, using the bureaucracy, unfair regulation that he supports. So he has kind of played politics, not using free market ingenuity, not really being a free market capitalist. I think he's the anti-establishment candidate like Bernie Sanders, who's like Pope Francis, going up against Hillary Clinton. But the more attention they give him by attacking
him. Tell you what, stay there. You're making some really good points, James. We are really fleshing out and investigating Trump. Third hour coming up. Stay there, James. Donald Trump is the big issue, eclipsing hundreds of others. We'll cover some of those issues he's been eclipsing, but we're taking your calls right now. James in Colorado was wargaming out what he sees is going on with Trump. James, finish your points, and please answer my question on this. What's your view on Trump himself? Do you think he's smoking his own propaganda, or do you think he's consciously met with the Clintons, or do you think he's for real?
I don't think he's for real. He did give $1 million to Clinton, supported Rahm Emanuel's Senate campaign. But another thing is his stance on Edward Snowden, where he made the claim that he's a traitor, that, you know, what do we used to do to traitors? We used to either execute them or put them in prison. Our country's weaker.
You know, I forgot about that. We should get all these clips together of Trump saying execute Snowden and, you know, supporting Hillary and all the rest of it. Not that I want to go after Trump. I just want to focus in on what he really stands for. I mean, again, we want to support him because what he's saying now is so true. But don't people get what you say versus what you do? It's what you do that's important.
The whole thing is that if you're saying Snowden's a traitor, you're basically saying he's evil, but he has difficulty saying the establishment is evil, so they're incompetent when they're the war criminal. And again, he's a politician, even if he hasn't held office, same way, you know, it's kind of a drastic example, but, you know, the CIA, they would film generals doing things to kids, blackmail them. I mean, it's still mob politics, regardless.
So who do you think Donald Trump is, deep down?
I agree with him on vaccines, and I agree with what he's saying, but I think the establishment is using him as a way to basically ignore Rand Paul. They know the more they attack him, the larger he grows, and I think he's for global government and would be happy to hold a position in a larger global structure.
I agree with you. Wow, what an informed, involved audience we have. Again, what should happen to Trump politically? You know he's being promised a lot if he is a shill to play the part of Judas Iscariot against America, because he knows what's going on. He's a smart guy. In 4 to 5, 6 years, if we don't turn this around, the country as we know it is gone. It's not like we're merging into some organic world government based on free market and prosperity. We're going into a world government that is top-down directed, anti-human, anti-prosperity. He could not be signing us on to something worse. James, that's my final question. How do you think Trump will shell out if he does do it? Or will he break off into a third party to make sure Hillary wins? How do you think he'll shell out? And then what do you think will end up happening to him politically?
Yeah, it's hard to say. I think that he'll attempt to run. Curious who his VP will be. Maybe he is partially for real, but you know what happened to Reagan? He got shot. And they considered, I think, even putting his VP in. He didn't play ball. So he could be real on some levels, but at the end of the day, it's like with Bush, he might support some small government measures, and it might even be important. You know, abortion is important to people, gun rights. But at the end of the day, I mean, if you're looking at illegal wars and the police state, things that are much larger, then none of that really matters.
All right, thank you so much. We're going to go to break and come back with Walt, Julia, Christian, Rich, and others. The toll-free number to join us is 800-259-9231. I think I'm doing a decent job of taking a lot of calls, but until the bottom of the hour, I'm going to take one call after the other. So just have your point ready. I'm not going to ask any questions. I might have a 15-second comment after you make your statement, and I'm going to move to the next person. So get ready after this break because I can feel it. I think I'm going to break the old paradigm of not going to calls. I think I'm going to take about 20 calls in the next 20 minutes. Straight ahead, 800-259-9231. Who is Donald Trump? And then at the bottom of the hour, a news blitz of over 100 stories that we haven't even hit yet. It's all coming up straight ahead. It's the InfoWar. We're doing an in-depth discussion on the Donald today. Is he a shill? Well, it doesn't really matter now because what he's saying is true. So they can tear that down. They can tear down the basic ideas of liberty. So we have to defend what he's saying and point out he's telling the truth and hope he's for real, but also understand he's given 2-1 to the Clintons, consulted them before he ran for president as a Republican. and, you know, gave money to Rahm Emanuel's campaign and has been pro-abortion, has been anti-gun. But then he comes out and says all this stuff the other Republicans won't say when they've got good track records, some of them. What's wrong with them? Why won't they do it? Because they're getting advised by some really bad people. The Republican Party are the people that gave us NAFTA and GATT with the Democrats. They're the ones that gave us Obamacare. I was talking to a pretty prominent Democrat in Texas a few weeks ago before I left to Europe, and they were like, oh, I know the insurance companies wrote it. Oh, Alex, the public will never figure it out. I mean, it's just what it is. It's just this acceptance of an engineered economy, a giant screw job. Meanwhile, Ferguson's blowing up again. Brown's buddy got shot, reportedly after he shot at cops. I don't know what's true. The government's so corrupt. I just know George Soros is funding the Black Lives Matter movement, taking over everybody that's in opposition to Hillary. Sanders and others can't have an event now without it being taken over by these people. But they don't do that to Hillary because George Soros runs these groups. And I'm not saying Bernie Sanders is good. It just shows Hillary is the one. And if you think the persecution against patriots has been bad under Obama, get ready with Hillary. Let's go back to your phone calls. Walt in Michigan, you're on the air. Thanks for calling.
Hello, Alex.
Hey, buddy, go ahead.
You got back from your trip from Rome, huh?
Very interesting investigation. We've got some documentaries coming out on it.
Yeah, well, Donald Trump went to Fordham Jesuit University, so did Bill Clinton went to Georgetown Jesuit University, and the Jesuit Pope is calling for a new world order just like Clinton did, just like Donald Trump has paid lots of money to new world order candidates. And Jeb Bush is a fourth degree Knight of Columbus bowing to the Pope of Rome in Rome. It's online. You can look up his photographs of him doing that. Rome controls the United States. The Jesuits control the Vatican from behind the scenes with Adolfo Nicholas, the Jesuit general, with the present Jesuit Pope.
Well, I mean, I'll say this. There's different camps. People think the Masons run it all, or they think the Pope runs it all, or they think the Jews run it all. And I don't think it's Catholics or Jews or Masons. I think it's corrupt groups and organizations that are basically globally hijacking control of all the major organizations. But you cannot deny that the main driving force worldwide for global government now, outside of the central banks, is the Catholic Church. And it is a fact. And it is biblical. I just wish that the opposition to problems in the Catholic Church itself wasn't so deceptive and lying and bad. That's part of the problem, is we're just a fallen world. But I appreciate your call. What do you think about Donald Trump?
Well, I think he's a shill. I think he's being sent in there to destroy any true opposition to the Pope's control of our country. And what religion are most of the monarchs of Europe, Alex? The Catholics.
Well, I mean, I know that after the fall of Rome and then the fall of the Byzantine Empire as well, that was the government. And I know that the Vatican pushed for the creation of the EU, but is exempt from it itself. So I hear you. I appreciate your call. I mean, look, we've never had a pope address the Congress. And again, from what I've researched, there's been a coup of the Catholic Church using sex crimes. They're being blackmailed, whether they were good before or bad before or a mix, whatever. This is even mainstream news that it's being blackmailed to do the bidding of the globalist. So regardless, it's globalist run now. And I mean, here it is in AP. Pope and Congress. Francis is certain to challenge lawmakers. We're going to have some religious leader in Congress from a foreign sovereign city on the banks of the Tiber, lecturing us and calling for open borders and all this. It's just crazy. And that shows how weak America is. I mean, we shouldn't have the head Buddhist leader or the head Jewish leader or the head Protestant leader, Billy Graham, address Congress. We have a separation of church and state. And that doesn't mean you can't have your religious views in a public institution. You can say a prayer at commencement. You can have a Bible at school. The state has no jurisdiction in that. We don't have state-run religion. I mean, this is unprecedented. All of this is unprecedented. All of it. I said I want to take a bunch of calls. This is one caller is all I got to there. Christian in Texas, you're on the air. Then Julia.
Hello?
Yes, go ahead.
Oh, yeah, Alex, thank you for taking my call. I'm 14 years old, but I've been listening to your show for about 2 years. But I told my parents and some friends, and I said, you know, I'm not old enough to vote, but, you know, people who are 18 and older, adults have the, you know, they can vote, and it affects them. And whatever, you know, what happened in this country affects them and affects, you know, us, the youth. But, you know, about Donald Trump, I just, you know, he seems good what he's talking about. And he seems like he's would make a great president. But I just have the feeling that if he does become president, that he's going to be just like Obama. You know, he went out there and said, oh, I'm not going to take your shotguns. I'm not going to take your handguns and I'm not going to take your semi-autos. But look what he's trying to do.
I hear you. And God bless you, Christian. As a 14-year-old listening for 2 years, what perspective has this broadcast given you?
It's really opened up my eyes and to see what's going on. I mean, I used to, you know, I didn't care for the news, but I figured out that, you know, all this stuff it affects us, and that, you know, and today's in schools, as me going to school, I mean, I realized that they're pretty much brainwashing us, and the stuff that they say, it's ridiculous.
Oh, like, it's outrageous. You know, bad-mouthing the Constitution, bad-mouthing the institution of marriage. Now they're saying marriage is bad because it hurts people's feelings. Again, it's cult-like. Good to hear from you. Appreciate your call. Julia in Kentucky, you're on the air.
Hi, Alex. Yeah, first of all, before I say anything else, before I talk about Donald Trump, I wanted to tell you to check out CERN, C-E-R-N, September 23rd, 2015, because there may not be another election. This might just be to cover up for a lot of stuff that's going on right now. But anyway, about Donald Trump, I wanted to say that he might be in some type of prostitution reign. I know I'm not trying to, you know, bring him down or anything, but that might be why the Clintons are trying to back him up, because my son worked for him in his casino in Indiana, and he worked at the gambling table. He was a dealer, and he met this woman there, and she was a Filipino woman. And she tried to fix him up. She actually did fix him up with her niece, who was from the Philippines. And she does this with a lot of women from the Philippines. I don't know what she's doing. Seems
well,
like
sure, but that's not prostitution, bringing in mail-order brides.
Well, she's doing more than that. My son believes that she's got some type of a prostitution ring thing going on with Donald Trump, because they're really good friends, and she's really rich. She's got a lot of money. She buys Mercedes and stuff
now,
like that.
Now, wait a minute. There are no prostitutes at casinos, okay? And there are no fishing lakes, and there's no birds in the sky. And I'm sure Donald Trump is perfect, wonderful guy. You can Google Donald Trump and women and him, you know, at the Miss America, whatever, all hanging on him. You know, I'm a libertarian. My view is on it, decriminalize it all, because making it criminal only allows it to be seedy and controlled by the mafia. But yeah, no, I mean, clearly Donald Trump has all the swagger and all the aplomb of a gangster. And he hangs out with gangsters like the Clintons. He says a lot of great stuff. It's good to see him slap a bunch of politically correct scumbags around. But that said, It doesn't pass the smell test, but I don't want to just get up here and, you know, speculate and claim that Donald Trump is in prostitution rings. I appreciate your call. I'll tell you what, DynCorp and Halliburton and others have been caught. And that doesn't mean if you work for Halliburton, you're involved. I'm going to be clear. But it came out in mainstream news, NBC News, Chicago Tribune, a decade ago, that they were running operations where they were grabbing underage women, boys, you name it, throwing them on C-130s, and they were just disappearing. And we knew this because UN people blew the whistle. So the sky's the limit. I mean, that's the thing. They'll bust some John you know, picking up a hooker on South Congress in Austin, Texas, and throw the book on them. At least they did in the old days. They don't really do that now. And then, though, if some big company is actually running, you know, sex trade with underage women brought into Houston, nothing's done about it. I mean, there are whole areas of the country where it's just well known they're running basically sex slaves into the country, out of the country, nothing's done. So if it's big, official, oppressive, white slavery. And every time I say that, I get an email going, oh, you don't care about black slavery? White slavery means sexual slavery, ladies and gentlemen. I know most of you know that, but if it's real slavery, they leave it alone. But if it's a woman on her own out there making some money, then they'll call it prostitution or whatever. And so I guess if you take a woman out to dinner and buy her jewelry, it's prostitution too. By their benchmark, they've had cases in this country where people hook up online and the woman wants to be taken to dinner and wants to be, you know, have something bought. And they're calling that prostitution in New York City and taking people's cars. Then meanwhile, it turns out the governor that passed the law is seeing high dollar hookers himself. We're going to go to Rich and others here in just a moment. Then I'm going to come back, hit a bunch of news we haven't really hit yet, play some important clips. You know, I don't want to say I have Ferguson fatigue, but just to see the public being played, because there is some police brutality, there is militarization of police, there are a lot of real problems. But the feds are globalist occupied. They want to smash local police departments, run them into the arms of the globalist. And that's why George Soros is spending over $100 million, 30-plus million in Ferguson alone, to stir this up, and has really hired a lot of nasty political operators to do it. And in most of the cases, the justifiable shootings the police are engaged in. There are other ones where they're absolutely executions. And when there's evidence of it, they're indicting the police officers. There's video of just a cop pulls a gun and just shoots a white person for no reason, or shoots a black person. It's crazy. And bigger than population, blacks being 13%, black males being about 6%, it is disproportionate black males being killed in cold blood. You just can't deny it. But compared to blacks dying from abortion or heart disease and all this other stuff, it just doesn't even show up on the scale. Less than 100, if you look at the numbers. Questionable black males being shot by police a year. That sounds like a big number. 100 out of 300 plus million people? I mean, it is just a total diversion from all the serious things, and then just creates racial animosity that, I mean, I grew up where you just knew racists were just idiots who just didn't like you because they were dumb, whether they were white or black. And now it gets to the point where even on King of the Hill years ago, Mike Judge made the point, we'll play a clip of that in a second, that how come I can only hate somebody if they're white? And it becomes this idea that whites commit more crime and whites are inherently bad. And it's just not historical. It's not accurate. In fact, here's that Hank Hill clip.
What the hell kind of country is this where I can only hate a man if he's white?
We need to get Mike Judge live on the show. He's a big listener, listens all the time. He even let me shoot video of us shooting out of his house a couple times. I never heard it for some reason. I need to hear that video. It's a pretty good video. Well, I got a little excited during one shot. It's probably why I haven't aired it. We've got like 15 people shooting 308s, AR-15s, you name it, at huge boxes of Tannerite. I say huge boxes, you know, maybe 5-10 pound boxes. And while I'm talking, a couple of them blow up, and there's pieces of cinder block flying around. And one of them hits me in the back of the head. Maybe that's why I never put that video out. But it was good fun. That wasn't one of the time I've had my kids out there shooting. Definitely a lot of fun. Let's talk to Rich in New York. Rich, you're on the air. Go ahead.
Hey, what's up, Alex? Donald Trump is a game show host. He's clown shoes. The guy panders to anyone who will line his pockets. He's a shill and a half and nothing more. you know, just like the way Beck once in a while would say some things are truth, because you have to mix lies with the truth in order to get people to even listen to what you say. This is what this guy is. Plain and simple. That's it.
Well, I've thought about going after Trump, and you could really do it, showing him in the WWE, showing him doing other stunts, showing him flip-flopping. I know. Well, then let me ask you this. Why won't the other Republicans, like Rand Paul, why won't they get hardcore and say the popular constitutional common sense? Why is it Trump?
It's easy, because probably because of fear, you know, for them, their families or whatnot. You're talking about gangsters here. You know, it may look at what, you know, it may look all nice on the outside, but what goes behind the scenes, we have no idea. I can guarantee you that these people are threatened, and these people have their backs up against the wall, and are told if they say anything, this might happen, that might happen. Who knows what'll happen? You know?
Yeah, I'm not allowed to say what I know about certain political candidates, but you're absolutely right. I've been told in confidence throughout the years, we'll just leave it at that, about some pretty wild stuff. And the weird thing is, when people get threatened or really weird stuff happens, I mean, we're talking in the category of horse heads in your bed. They know it'll sound crazy if you come out in the news and talk about it, so people just don't discuss it. So you're absolutely right. Stay there, Rich. I want you to have time to finish up. You've held for 20 minutes, and then we'll go to Steve, Rich, Jeff, Mike. I'm going to blitz through these calls, 1 minute apiece, going back to Rich, and then I'm going to hit the news and then back into calls. I've done pretty good today. I've taken like 30-something calls. 800-259-9231. We're focusing on Planet Trumpus. By the way, there's an article out today. The golden age of muscle cars is now in USA Today. And I absolutely agree with USA Today. I have some friends and folks that have things like the new Corvettes and things like that. And let me tell you, I've driven 600 horsepower Porsches. I've driven all sorts of cars that were just made, you know, 10, 15, 20 years ago. They are nothing compared to American muscle now. Nothing. And I might as well just make this announcement, only because I want to celebrate pure Americana. I was getting a Jeep, trading in an old Jeep that I'd had for 15 years or so, about 2 years ago. And the fella at the Jeep dealership, so I try to buy American when I can. Now it's owned by Fiat, of course, but still made here. I said, hey, you know, this is a really cool Dodge Viper, but I never get one of these. Plus, I know it's not that fast compared to some other cars. And he goes, wait till the Dodge Hellcat comes out. You ought to get one. He goes, a comparable car would be about $500,000, a lower-end Ferrari, and it'll beat those. And I said, you know what? Put me on the list. Well, I got one of the first run. I've had it like 6-8 months now. And the car, there's just nothing like it. And I think I'm going to do a video on it because it's pure Americana. And it wasn't that expensive. I think I could sell it for more than double what I bought it for right now. But I got it as a celebration of Americana. And and the reason I never announced I got a Hellcat was I wanted to do a whole piece on it and properly tie it in to just how amazing the John Wayne of cars is. I mean, it's just sick. Of course, I've driven out in Hollywood with friends before. I'm not name dropping. Somebody's like, hey, here, you want to drive this Ferrari? You know, 800 horsepower Ferraris that cost $1 million. Just nothing compared to this. And it drives like a family car. It just drives normal, nice, and then you hit the accelerator, and there's nothing like it. I mean, I'm not going to tell you I've been speeding in it, but because that's not safe. But I've now digressed, and I apologize. But the golden age of the muscle car, I was going to tie it into innovation and things like that. But despite strict emission limits, concerns about climate change, and unpredictable gasoline prices that would make a 60s hot rodder pull over and weep, Detroit's modern performance cars could run rings around the classics. And they're surprisingly affordable. Yeah, that's the thing. When compared to the price tags of some exotic cars with similarly high-performing engines. Because, see, here's the truth. I like high horsepower cars. I don't like standing out. So when you're driving a black Challenger or a gray Challenger, the colors they come in, no one knows it's got 780 horsepower because everybody says it's 707. That was the original to get around the emissions testing and all the government harassment. They've done drivetrain tests. You can look this up. It's got close to 800 horsepower. And here's the difference. It delivers it all down the drivetrain. All right, I'm talking about this like I'm talking about Marilyn Monroe. Back in the 60s and 70s, we were looking at 300, 325 horsepower engines. Now you're at 500, 600, and 700, said Ken Gross, an automotive historian, a museum consultant, and journalist. Never in my lifetime did I think I'd see the day when I could drive a 700 horsepower streetcar. Yeah. Even the least powerful of today's sports cars, say a base 7.6 Chevy Camaro, Mustang, or Charger, could probably out-corner most of the 60 muscle cars, which were renowned to their ability to accelerate but not to turn or stop. Oh, yeah. I had some guy about a month ago run a red light. Just light turns green. I'm going like 45 miles an hour, going the speed limit. Turns green way up ahead, no cars ahead of me, and this car just runs it. This was like a Chevy Silverado, and my car turned like it was on rails. I turned and didn't hit him. I mean, turn on a dime, and that's human innovation. And believe me, folks, they've got technology 10 times better than that. I mean, it's just so much more advanced than we even know. And the globalists are all about suppressing innovation. And sure, it's wasteful. Sure, we should try to conserve. But it shouldn't be forced on us, is my point. And see, I never did the report because I didn't know how to address it, how to properly give justice to it. But I think I'm going to take folks out in the Hellcat, the audience, maybe with a live stream or something. And maybe we'll take that baby out of the racetrack. I know Buckley was out at the racetrack with a buddy's car. Had it going 170 two weekends ago. But, you know, then I think I don't need to be taking risk like that when I'm fighting the New World Order. That's why I haven't gone skydiving. It's why I don't jump off railroad trestles 300 feet into water anymore, stuff I used to do, because I don't want to get hurt. I got children. And that's why I don't really speed that much in the Hellcat. It's almost a joke that I have it because I don't really use it that much. It's just fun to be able to shoot around a couple cars real quick. And it has the twin superchargers, and when you and then the second you put your foot on the gas, you just hear them power up. It goes, vroom. I mean, it's amazing. And then you got folks that put big pipes on their cars because they want to sound loud. This has pipes to try to dampen it. When I fire it up, it rumbles the building in here. But I just like human innovation. I like muscle cars. I like Americana. And I'm sorry I just digressed off into this. You know, I wish that Donald Trump would be the muscle car of patriots, but I'm afraid he may be something else. I apologize, Rich, for going off on a six-minute diatribe about muscle cars. Go ahead.
No, that's cool, man. I like them, too. Just a quick note, if I could, Alex. Alex, you always talk about them, about the globalists being like an alien race. Well, there's an interesting read, if you ever get a chance to read it. It's an article that was changed into a book. It's called Transylvania to Tunbridge Wells by a guy named DeVere. And it's really, really interesting. These are who these people think they are. It's really interesting. It's tied in a bit with that Sitchin stuff, but it's really, really interesting. It goes into that. It's connected with that whole Holy Blood, Holy Grail, that Dan Brown stuff. All of it.
Sure, the Merovingian line. Well, I mean, here's the deal. I've been to Bohemian Grove. I've covered Skull and Bones. The elite really believe they're channeling spirits. They literally believe they're psychic vampires. And they've got the power. And they know a lot of secret stuff the public doesn't know. I think they're mentally ill. But there's the article from Transylvania to Tunbridge Wells. And then what is it basically saying? That they're a devil cult? Or What's it break down?
No, what it's basically saying, it gets into the whole thing with the Sitchin stuff, where you know, Nibiru, but they're saying that they spliced their DNA with the hominids that were here and created what was known as the first modern man. This is where you get the vampires, the idea of vampires from. This is where you get the idea of dwarves and all the rest of that from. And they were considered a first race that was biologically wired different than we are. You know, this is where you get into the whole thing with the drinking of blood and stuff like that. I mean, you have it in the Catholic Church, and no one knows why it's there. There's a lot of stuff in there. There's a real lot of stuff in there. These are who these people think they are. That's why you had intermarrying inside, you know, pharaohic marriage, you know, like you did with the Egyptians. You had the same thing going on in England and stuff, because they wanted to maintain the bloodlines. Why is the bloodline so important? Because this is what they believe. They believe that, I mean, that's why you even get it in movies. You get
I know. It's everywhere. And the question is, were they delusional? Because, you know, the Egyptians also thought if they mummified their body, they'd live forever. Or was there something real to it? I know this. I've been to pharaoh exhibits in Europe, in New York, in Houston, and they've got the skeletons of these pharaohs, and they look like space aliens. And the reason I say they think they're another species is you can Google elite to split into new species. You'll get mainstream news articles where they're saying they believe they're already a new species separate from us. So they believe it. And then they act like it, and they act like we're here to be fed on. I mean, look, in secret, they've been harvesting babies for decades, lying to us. Yeah, there it is, Daily Mail. Human race will split into two different species. Small goblin-like dwarfs of the general public and beautiful, smart elites, you know, in the next 100 years or whatever. All right, I appreciate your call. Good to hear from you. Let's go to Steven in Florida. You're on the air. Welcome.
Yeah, hey, Alex. Real quick, just want to say the first three things I take every morning is Acts 2, Secret 12, and Super Male, and I'm definitely sold. And I've got Silver Bullet and several of the other products as well. So for that guy that says you're selling snake oil, well, I must have been bitten because I'm hooked.
Well, God bless you, and thanks for the support, brother.
Yes, sir. Appreciate it. Real quick, as far as Trump, okay, I'm just going to go down through the line of the candidates. Marco Rubio, any guy that says the Fourth Amendment isn't worth upholding and the NSA's and spying, that guy doesn't know what he's talking about. Mike Huckabee, I want to remind people, this guy's a member of the CFR. Richard Haass, the head of the CFR, was his presidential advisor in 2008. That shoots him down as far as I'm concerned. Rick Perry, 2007, Bilderberg, Pakistan, violation of the Logan Act and the HPV vaccine debacle back in 2008 in Texas. He's a liar. Chris Christie, he wants to be the Republican nominee, so as far as I'm concerned, he's a fat sack of elephant dung, because that's all that comes out of him when he speaks, and he ought to be ashamed of himself the way he did with Rand Paul. Speaking of which, Ben Carson, here's a man that professes to be a Christian. He caved on the same-sex issue. But also on Hugh Hewitt's show, as David Knight showed yesterday, he criticized Rand Paul as being uncivilized, and yet Rand Paul hasn't really been that hard. He should be harder on these guys. Now, as far as Donald Trump, here's an issue nobody's bringing up about this guy, and this is why I have a problem with Donald Trump. You brought up the casino issue, and that's a biggie. And, you know, the fact he's given to the Clintons, but here's the one nobody's talking about. This man's an adulterer. He committed adultery on Ivana Trump. His wife couldn't trust him, so how in the world can I? It is a moral and a spiritual and a character issue. A man like that, as far as I'm concerned, should never be in the White House, even if he's saying a lot of the right things.
Very interesting point, Steve. Thank you for the call. Jeff in California. I said I'd get to news, but I'm all over the map here. Jeff, you're on the air. Go ahead.
Hey, Alex, how's it going?
Good, brother.
Hey, you know, everybody I talk to, you know, ask me, what do you think of Donald Trump? You know, here's a man, he's clearly, he has a lot of wealth. And, you know, according to Salente and all the other experts, we're heading for a collapse. So, you know, Donald's always talking about being a part of the winning team. Well, I think we have to ask Donald, you know, whose team is he playing on? You know, I think that he's, you know, he knows what's going on. I think he's protecting his own interests. And, you know, of course he's corrupt. I mean, he admitted during the debates that he's bought off politicians. And, you know, so you know, he's not a squeaky clean guy. So, you know.
Well, he's also real smart. He hides it in plain view and doesn't apologize.
Right, exactly. You know, and another thing is that, you know, the globalists, look how much time they spent grooming Obama for the presidency. There's no doubt about it that they got their hands all over this election. And, you know, I think that if he was a real patriot, that he would be supporting somebody like Rand Paul.
Well, instead, you see the entire system attacking Rand Paul and now eclipsing him with Trump. And that's because they know Rand Paul's for real. He's not perfect, but he's being demonized because they know he is the real deal. And I'm just glad Trump is raising these issues. I'm glad he's making them issues. That's positive. And I think that's why I'm still reserving judgment. We're exposing what he did. We're saying we don't trust him, but we're saying we hope he's for real. We hope he doesn't scam us. We hope he doesn't drop the ball. But we're watching. That's what it comes down to. Thank you so much, Jeff. Since the caller before last mentioned the products, we fund this operation. The reporters, the news sites, the nightly news, 7 o'clock weeknights, the syndicated radio transmission, all of this that costs a lot of money by selling high-quality products. And by selling high-quality products, we begin to have a lot of success in the market because people get a good response. I set out to put out the most powerful super male, super female vitality boosting system I could with the most concentrated herbs and natural compounds, cold-pressed, organic, that are known to get your body to release the different compounds from your glands that we need and to basically counteract the chemicals, the estrogen mimickers. And you've seen on third-party sites, if you go to InfoWarsLife.com, we have links to major respected third-party sites, some of the most respected out there, with five-star ratings out of thousands. And, you know, these products at first, we started selling them 3 years ago, didn't sell very well. But I knew they would and help fund our operation once people used them. Once people used them. And, I mean, a lot of the vitamin heads, a lot of the real supplement snobs are getting into InfoWarsLife.com products because they're that good. And SuperMel's been sold out for almost a month. SuperMel Vitality is now back in stock. And when you purchase it, know this. Leading competitors that we know use dry herbs, but the same ingredients pretty much. It's very hard to use wet. That is, they're fresh. Are about twice or about 80% more. Okay, so you're getting a top flight formula for a very competitive price, and it helps fund our operation. I know we've got the best iodine, X2. I know we've got the best throat lung cleanse spray. I mean, it's like the only problem is you got to wash the sprayer out a lot because it's so thick it clogs. I mean, it's like super heavy essential oils. Most people just put out a bunch of marketing and then put crud out. Our Prostaguard is hands down the best prostate defense system out there with all the key ingredients at half the price of a leading competitor that just has one ingredient. And ours has just as much saw palmetto as the leading competitor and costs half as much. It has as much as leading competitor and then a whole bunch of other ingredients. 10 total ingredients. Prostaguard. InfoWarsLife.com. Supermel Vitality is back. This segment of the program is brought to you by Supermel Vitality. Supermel Vitality is now back in stock. InfoWarsLife.com. We're being sold out for weeks. Our new emergency shipment just arrived at our warehouse last Friday. It's now available for sale. We know our bodies are under hormonal attack, and it's time to fight back. The new Ultra Strength is even stronger. Supermel Vitality formula has hundreds of five-star reviews and is truly life-changing. Read the hundreds of other reviews and experience Supermel Vitality for yourself at InfoWarsLife.com. All right, we're going to come back. I've got to hit some of the news I didn't get to, and then we'll go into overdrive and take calls. Who knows, we might do a half-hour overdrive. But I've got so much I need to get done around the office as well. There's going to be a lot of special reports getting filed, a lot of bombshell interviews. We got contacted by one of the top astronauts in the world that wants to break something big here tomorrow. It's all coming up. Nico's now had time to talk more to the astronaut who we'll surprise you with tomorrow. He was in Austin when I was in Europe. He wanted to just come by and meet me. And then now I'm gonna call him after the show and find out specifically. I'll never forget the time Buzz Aldrin was on. And what he said ended up becoming international news. So we'll go all over the place with our guest tomorrow. Of course, a lot of it's secret because he commanded more of the secret military missions from what I've seen in the news than anybody else. So, you know, about 80% of NASA's secret. So I'm not going to say any more. And it's like the time we got contacted by the head of HARP who wanted to come on. And then by the middle of it, a colonel came on and cut the interview off. But that was a civilian head of HARP's been on. We have a lot of cool listeners. I'm very honored to have all these neat people listening. And most folks I meet from government or major corporations actually want to have a better world. But they're high level, but not at the very highest levels. And it's the very highest levels that some really nasty people. And their argument is, hey, there are a lot of really bad people out there. We got to be even nastier to protect the good people. That's a Machiavelli view that the end justifies the means and historically leads to some very bad things. But we ought to try to fly this guy in. I'd love to have him in studio. That's just amazing. That's the greatest part about this job is it's so humbling to have William Binney in here, former technical director of the NSA, one of the most famous code breakers in the world who invented most of this stuff. I mean, I get to have Ron Paul on. I get to have all these cool people. I mean, it's just humbling. I get to talk to you, the listeners. You folks are just amazing. You know, there's no way to do justice to all this. I had all this Ferguson research, all this stuff I was going to play. I had all this media censorship news I wanted to get to. FBI still hiding 58-year-old documents about Eisenhower Roosevelt, who is now the favorite to appear on the $10 bill. Who are they going to replace off the $10 bill? Who's on the 10 now? I forget.
I think it's Hamilton.
Hamilton? No, he's on the 20. I don't know.
That's Jackson.
Jackson. Oh, they're going to start. He's the racist. Oh, my gosh.
Eleanor Roosevelt or
Eleanor Roosevelt, who's an occultist and a lesbian. But, I mean, if she is those things, just be honest about it. Put Janet Reno on the $10 bill. And they can have little burning children all engraved on it. And then you can have memorialized her when the police caught her in Miami with a 12-year-old girl in the back of her car with vomit all over because Reno had passed out on pain pills and whiskey. Then we just have, like, on the back of the $10 bill can be Reno with a half-naked girl vomiting on her. And then if you're against that, you're against diversity. And then we can have Clinton raping a woman on the front, biting her on the lip while he rapes her. I mean, why not? He did it, and if he's God, then it's okay. Right? And then on the other side of the bill, we can have like a DynCorp airplane with little kids getting loaded on it. But have it, you know, micro-engraved, so you got to have a magnifying glass to see all of it. The one thing I like Trump's done is that he has come out and called for cutting taxes. And the second thing I like is, you know, saying that he believes autism spectrum disorders are linked to vaccines. But, I mean, you've got most of the public believing that now and the evidence showing it. So he's kind of going with the party there. AP, mysterious fungus killing snakes in at least 9 states. Hidden on the hillsides of a remote part of western Vermont, a small number of venomous timber rattlesnakes slither among the rocks. But their isolation can't protect them from the mysterious fungus spreading across the eastern half of the country that threatens to wipe them out. And the evidence shows it's linked to GMO. Hey, the honeybees are dying too. What's the big deal? I mean, if you don't want to kill the honeybees, you're racist against Roundup. Drink the Roundup or you're racist. Drink. World government loves you.
Genesis Communications.
Everything's fine. We'll be back. Stay with us. Nightly News tonight, 7 o'clock. Let's talk to Mike in Virginia. Mike in Virginia, thanks for holding.
Hey, how you doing, Alex? What's up?
Good, brother. Thanks for calling.
Okay, shalom aleichem to you. First off, you're a hell of a researcher, and I wish you would look at a book called Fossilized Customs, Come Out of Her, My People, and The Remnant Ministry. But anyway, on Donald Trump, I think he's a major distractor of Rand Paul.
Yep.
They did this with Ron Paul, because that's why Ron Paul never got in the White House. And
that's what Huckabee was for then, yeah.
Exactly. And this is exactly what they're doing with Rand Paul. Yes, it's great that Trump is bringing out all this information and all the truth. But like you say, he's mixing truth with lies, you know. And he's such a Clinton supporter and everything. And I'm afraid he's going to flip-flop at the end and hand the whole election over to Hillary Clinton. You know?
Well, any way you look at it, that's what he does if he drops out or runs third party. And I just can't imagine Hillary Clinton as president. I don't want to say I'm going to leave the country, but I'm going to be honest. I may be forced to leave the country if she gets elected. I mean, they're already after me. It's already come out in the news that I'm on their enemies list. Matt Drudge is on it. WorldNet Daily's on it. And I'm not afraid of them, but I'm also not in a suicide pact. I just want to be left alone. I'm not here in some battle with the Clintons. They're a bunch of crooks destroying my country, and I would be remiss if I didn't stand up against them. That said, if this country elects Hillary Clinton, I just can't handle it anymore. I mean, Hillary is so evil. God bless you. I appreciate your call, Mike. I actually started having an anxiety attack just for a second. I mean, I can't handle it anymore. God, these people are evil. But I mean, we're not doing anything about them aborting babies and selling their body parts. I mean, the sky's the limit. We are just screwed. I'm not trying to be negative. There's a lot of waking up happening, a lot of good things happening. It's just, I am so sick of the Clintons. I have been on air 20 years. And I know all about them, and they're just so evil and so manipulative and so bad. Let's talk to Robert in California. Robert, you're on the air. Go ahead.
Hey, Alex, how you doing, man?
I was just really thinking about, I was processing Hillary as president, and I was getting physically nauseous.
Yeah, me too. Listen, I think Trump is going to be the idiocracy of America. I think he's going to be, what was that guy's name? From that movie is President Camacho. He's going to be a Camacho. He's got the lingo down and everything.
Thought your head would be bigger. Look like a peanut.
Yeah, you got it, man.
So you smart, huh? That's a great movie. What's your favorite part of Idiocracy?
God, I don't know. It's just mind-boggling, man. Really, it is. I think the whole thing about, what was that drink where he's at the table and he's
Brondo.
Like water. Like, yeah, Brondo.
He goes, water? Like out of the toilet? Yeah.
Yeah. And he's going, you know, they're going like, Brondo. Brondo's got electrolytes. It's like, do you even know what electrolyte is?
Brondo's got electrolytes that plants crave.
That right there is where they're going around the table. That, I think, was one of my favorite parts.
Yeah, you know, Fox owned that movie, and they wouldn't even release it. It was not even released, and the movie was deep-sixed and is now a cult classic and has sold millions on DVD, millions of copies. Appreciate you calling. Look, I'm out of time. I would come back with more Overdrive. Mike, Morgan, Christian, if you call back tomorrow, I'll put you to the head of the line. I got to some of the news, but hey, doesn't matter. I took more calls today than I've taken in years in one sitting. And so we're going to shake the show up this week. Got a lot of special reports, a lot of big guests coming up. You do not want to miss these broadcasts this week. Please spread the word. We really do have the power. I mean, look, folks know about the Federal Reserve now. They know about a lot of this stuff. So we are...